देखोगी तो भेजूंगे आपको, देखती हो प्लीज।
भेजा था ना 60 क्लब पे, वही मेरे पास तो यूट्यूब में नहीं खुल रहा अभी।
आ गया, वेबिनार इज नाउ स्ट्रीमिंग लाइव ऑन यूट्यूब, लेकिन यूट्यूब में आ रहा है मेरे पास। आई एम एबल टू सी हिमांशुस पिक्चर ऑन यूट्यूब ऑल्सो।
हाँ अरे आ रहा है,
आ रहा है,
आ रहा है।
आगे वेबिनार इज नाउ स्ट्रीमिंग लाइव ऑन यूट्यूब, लेकिन यूट्यूब में आ रहा है मेरे पास।
हाँ जो बोल रहे हैं उनकी फिगर भी आ रही है, वो आर स्पीकिंग उनका नाम, वो भी आ रहा है सर में। मने बोलो ये 6:30 तक चलेगा
क्या?
तुमको नीचे देखना है YouTube पे, नीचे देख सकती हो। मैं तुमको
म्यूट कर लो।
सर जी, वी कैन स्टार्ट नाउ।
या विक्रांत,
या
आर यू रेडी?
Yeah.
So I think we can start now. Rajak. Hello, Rajak.
Rajak, आप muted हैं. Please unmute yourself.
Yes.
Yeah, Rajak. We can start now.
Okay. I am audible.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So. Good evening to one and all, respected chief guest of the program, Professor Ajit Chaturvedi, Director IIT Roorkee, respected guest of honor, Professor Sudhirgan, Director IIT
Roorkee,
respected senior alumni of IIT Roorkee, other IITs and institutes, dear professionals and students, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of IIT Roorkee Alumni Association Ahmedabad, I welcome you all to this water management lecture series, which is organized by IIT Roorkee Ahmedabad from January 16 to January 31, 2021. Before we move ahead with the program, let us begin our program with lamp lighting and a prayer. We know well begun is half done. And to make beginning good, we start our activities with a prayer. May I request Dr. Vikrant Jain to please play a prayer video.
Shubham Kurat Pankaj.
Now, before we go ahead with our today's further program, let me introduce myself. I am D. Ram Rajak, the anchor of this program. I did my ME in civil engineering from IIT Roorkee in 1990. I am a remote sensing scientist at Space Applications Center, ISRO, Ahmedabad. As I told you, that this lecture series has been organized by AITRA, that is IIT Roorkee Alumni Association, Ahmedabad. Many of you are aware about AITRA Ahmedabad, its objectives, its members, and the kind of activities it takes up. There may be some participants who may not be knowing the details of AITRA. Hence, I request Sri Deepak Mathur, who is Vice President of AITRA Ahmedabad, and who supports all its activities proactively. He will tell us about AITRA in brief to present some glimpses of AITRA activities. May I request Sri Deepak Mathur sir. Mathur sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Rajak. And good evening, everyone. So my presentation is on the activities of IIT Roorkee Alumni Association Ahmedabad, as Rajak explained you. And I'll request Dr. Vikrant to help me in running the slides of my presentation. Dr. Vikrant, please. So you can move to the next slide. I think this is fine. So yes, fine. My presentation will be having two parts. I'll be talking about a bit of history, how Thompson College of Engineering came into presence. Then I will be talking about University of Roorkee, and then finally it is becoming how it became IIT Roorkee. And many of our participants, I understand, they do not know the glorious past of the great institution. So I'll be discussing on that. And the second part I would be discussing, or I would be just telling you a brief on alumni activities of ITRA Ahmedabad. So next slide, Vikrant. So this is the iconic building of IIT Roorkee, and we all are proud of this particular building. And this is as old as this inception of this college was. And in fact, if we go there and we feel proud of this building because it is maintained in such an excellent way, and it looks new today. And if you see the right-hand corner, right-hand side of the building photograph, you will find a sundial. And I'm really happy to say that this is meticulously and maintained in an excellent way. And the clock which you see in the middle of the lower picture, that that is as old as the building is, and it is perfectly working fine, and it gives you accurate time today. So we all are proud of this particular iconic building of IIT Roorkee, which was earlier University of Roorkee, and that is known as the Sir J.J. Thompson Building. I'll be talking about history a bit in my later slides. Next slide, Dr. Vikram. So this is the engineering marvel of Roorkee. And these engineering marvels are basically the genesis of this engineering college, which came for the want of a construction of Ganga Canal. And when the canal was being constructed, there was a need of technical manpower, and one institute was created to train those technical manpower, and then that was converted into an engineering college, then it became a university, and then ultimately became it IIT. And whatever monument you see, that is very, very old, and that is the before the at the time when this great engineering college was being conceptualized. Next slide, please. So this is what I will talk about, something about the history of the Roorkee. Canal was started in the river Ganga, and that was 1842. And the canal crosses over the river Sulani through aqueduct. And that is the oldest aqueduct in India. That is the engineering model which I was talking about in my previous slide. And the canal also passes through the base of the river. And you will see the in the right-hand side, the upper photograph, that is the aqueduct which I'm talking about. Next slide, please. So 1845, these are the dates. These are the very important dates. If you talk about the great institution today, that 1845, when the training school to train technical manpower for the canal project was started. And in 1846, the proposal was submitted to James Thompson. And 1847 was the year when College of Engineering was started at Roorkee. So that is the year when that marked the history in the this IIT Roorkee's history. And in 1854, college was renamed as Thompson College of Civil Engineering. Next slide, please. Previous slide, please. Yeah. So 1857, this is very important because since beginning of this college, we were interested in quality of manpower, and entrance test was started in 1857. And then in 1864, the college was affiliated to Calcutta University. Then affiliation was shifted after 30 years to the Allahabad University. And in 1909, engineering courses were started. And in 1947, College of Engineering, it was renamed as Thompson College of Civil Engineering. Next slide. And in quickly, then in 1949, it was given the status of University of Roorkee, and it was the first technical university in Asia. And the status was given at the time of when the Pandit Nehru was the prime minister. And in 2001, it became IIT. That was the seventh IIT, and that was declared by then PM Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And today it is. It has largest number of departments among all the universities and IITs, and we have 21 departments, three center of excellence. Probably number might have increased. Professor Chaturvedi would be telling us in his address, and we have got five service centers. So next slide. So this is the journey which we have traversed. In 1847, then after 100 years, it became Thompson College of Engineering. Then in 1949, it became University of Roorkee. And in 2001, IIT Roorkee. So if I talk about a bit of IITs, then it came into existence in 1950 to 1960. And University of Roorkee and I helped a lot in making those IITs. So most of the faculties were either trained or taken from University of Roorkee. Next slide. One second, Vikrant, can you stay just So we have traversed from University of Roorkee to IIT Roorkee, but our tagline remains same, Shivam Bina Na Kimapi Sadhyam. So we are just maintaining that that was in the our logo when it was University of Roorkee, and today also in IIT Roorkee, we are keeping Shivam Bina Na Kimapi Sadhyam. Next slide. So I've been talking something about our activities as Alumni Association in Ahmedabad. Next slide. So originally, the association was established and registered in Roorkee in 1940. That time it was not University of Roorkee. That time it was Thompson College of Civil Engineering. And we started in Ahmedabad in 1983. Almost we are completing 38 years. And we have about 150, even more than 150 alumni in Ahmedabad. We are a registered society. We have got a registered office. We have got our website, and we are very much visible on social media. Next slide, please. So we also have our members from all walks of life. We have from all departments. We have got members from IAS, IPS cadre also. We have got from government. We have from public sector, private sector, and educational institutions. So our members are diverse, and our annual membership is very, very less. We only charge 2,000 rupees as an annual membership from our members, but that we cater to 2 to 3 function family get together. We also do a lot of programs. All our get togethers are followed by dinner. And we also have option of life membership, that is 20,000 per annum we take, and we have got good number of life members in our association. Next slide, please. Yeah, so this is our governing council, and Mr. A.C. Mathur is our current president, one of the very active alumni of, I will say, not only Ahmedabad, but overall, ITRA, and past president is Dr. Sudhir Jain, and I'm really glad to share with you, and you, all of you know that he was confirmed Padma Shri last year, and we all are proud of his recognitions, and we have two vice presidents, we have secretary, we have joint secretary, then we have treasurer and joint treasurer. We also have executive committee members, where those members come from almost all. They cover almost all sectors, the government sector, private sector, or public sector. So we invite members from all sectors in our executive committee. Even our past presidents are very, very active. We have got past presidents in our executive committee, Mr. N.M. Bijlani, Mr. Vijay Kumar, Mrs. Kumar Mukherjee, and Mr. Deshraj. They are very, very active member of our executive committee. They immensely contribute in our activities. They support our activities, and they help in formulating strategies for our alumni association. Couple of our presidents are outside of Ahmedabad, like Mr. V.S. Vash, Mr. S.K. Gupta, and Mr. Bhargava. So they are not residing in Ahmedabad, but they are connected with all of us. So we are very active as far as the Alumni Association is concerned. Next slide. These are some of the activities which I'm just showcasing before you. We do philanthropic activities. We have run a couple of fundraising programs for the cause. We do a lot of social activities, family get-togethers, and we help social cause also through social activities. We organize so many cultural programs. Our members, their family members, they part in those programs, and some of the pictures you would be seeing that where our members and their family members are participating. And we regularly organize such programs, and our association is not the association of only our alumni, but it is the association of our family members too. And we also organize educational activities. We do a lot of technical activities. We have invited lectures, and we are also doing webinars. Next slide, Dr. Vikram. We started 4 years back this Dr. A.N. Khosla lecture series, and we in this particular lecture series, we invite our own alumni who have done excellence in engineering and technology field. And first lecture was given by Shri Mangu Singh, and then we had Shri Achal Khare for another lecture, and we also organized on disaster risk, and we also invited Mr. Gupta for vision on Sagarmala. So these programs we did under Ian Khosla lecture series, and in fact in 2020 we could not do because of this pandemic, but we are planning to do in the virtual mode, and I'll be talking about our initiative in the next slide. Next slide, please. So this is another feature of Ahmedabad Alumni Association of IIT Roorkee. We also come out with our news bulletin Vani, and this is being managed by our own members. In fact, Vijay Kumar, our past president, he and his family takes a lot of interest in that, and they organize. They are doing this this Vani, and in fact, it is very well participated by the family, family members, children, and our own members. And this is also sent to almost all chapters of ITRA across the world. Next slide, please. So this is the new initiative, webinar series on water management. And I let me share with you that this is the brainchild of our past president, Dr. Sudhir Jain, and current president, Sri A.C. Mathur. They thought of doing this webinar for our member engagement, and providing the technical information which we have, technical knowledge which we have to share with the society. And the initiative is being really today inaugurated by our own director of IIT Roorkee, Professor Ajit Chaturvedi. Thank you very much, sir, for your kind gesture, for your kind acceptance to this invitation. And IIT Roorkee Alumni Association, Ahmedabad, once again, welcomes you and Dr. Sudhir Jain for their gracious presence. Thank you very much for this opportunity to present this before you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you, Sri Deepak Mathurji, for briefly telling us about the ITRA Ahmedabad. Now you know about ITRA and its activities. So now it is very obvious to know why and how ITRA Ahmedabad has taken up to organize water management lecture series. Basically, it's a journey. So as Deepak Mathurji already told, it is a brainchild of our Sri A.C. Mathur and Dr. Sudhir Jain. Mathur sir is currently president of ITRA Ahmedabad, and he is also the founder of ITRA ILTED. ITRA Ahmedabad is one of the most vibrant chapters of ITRA. It is because of the untiring and dedicated efforts made by Sri A.C. Mathur that ITRA is really doing excellent. I request Dr. Vikrant Jain to please tell us about the objectives of this lecture series and how it all started. Dr. Vikrant Jain is M.Tech from IIT Roorkee and PhD from IIT Kanpur. Currently, he is an Earth Sciences professor at IIT Gandhinagar. So, I request Dr. Vikrant Jain. Dr. Vikrant Jain, please.
Many thanks, Dr. Rajak, and respected Professor A.K. Chaturvedi, sir, and respected Professor S.K. Jain, and all our colleagues at ITRA, and also all the participants. I welcome you in this webinar, and I would like to highlight that what are the main initiative and why have you started thinking about water seminar on the water. We all know about the significance of water in our life, and even in the past, the recent studies on the Sabarmati, the Vedic Saraswati River has highlighted that it is the disappearance of Saraswati River which has the major impact on the major collapse of the Harappan civilization. That was the past, but even in the present, we know that these water bodies are shrinking, rivers are in bad shape, groundwater is declining. So there are the major challenges is there in the water resources. And over the planet of Earth, the amount of water is limited. It's only 0.03% water is available as river, lakes, and as the atmospheric precipitation. And only 0.5% is available as a groundwater, whereas most of the groundwater is at the deeper level. And it means that more than 99% of water is logged either in ocean or in the glaciers in this part. And even this least amount of water, and which is precious, as not only precious but essential, we are not able to manage sustainably, and is and the availability of water for the future generation is a major question. So there is a need to discuss about this, to know about what are the problems in these areas. And because of these things, we had many such discussion within our ITRA, and we also decided that we should also initiate some academic activity. Last year, early 2020, we planned a major seminar in the earlier part of 2020, but because of the pandemic conditions, it was not possible, and we have to abandon the plan. And recently, again, we had discussed and we had then planned to start this webinar series on this important topic of the water management in the areas. And why not water management through the ITRA or IIT Roorkee Alumni Association, because IIT Roorkee has a very long association with water. It is not only the association, but in fact, as we have seen in the history, the journey of the institute started with water. It was the major initiation was to support a major construction of the Ganga Canal, and that's how this engineering college has come, which was also the first engineering college in India during the British Empire. And that first college has led to a number of water-related activity, and it become the happening academic place on the water research areas. And today, there are not only one or two, but there are a number of departments who are directly involved in the water research. Some of these are Department of Civil Engineering, Department of Hydrology, Department of Earth Sciences, Department of Water Resources Development and Management, Department of Hydro and Renewable Energies. Besides this, there are also some dedicated center of excellence in the area of water for welfare and disaster mitigation and management. So IIT Roorkee is doing, it is the place for the water related research activities. And that was the reason that number of alumni has moved from the institute and then contributed significantly on the water related aspect. There are number of aspects are there. And so ITRA has taken this opportunity that to invite some of those workers who are already making a significant contribution on those aspects and requested them to share that knowledge on those areas. And that's how this whole webinar series has been resulted. This webinar series will include six talks. And the first talk, first inaugural talk will be by Dr. R.C. Jain, who is the 1977 alumni from Earth Sciences Department. He was the former chairman of the Central Groundwater Board and also Central Groundwater Authority. And at present, he is an advisor to the government of Gujarat. He will discuss about the groundwater resources and sustainability. Second talk will be by me. I am, as Dr. Rajak has informed, I am 1995 alumni of Department of Earth Sciences. And I will discuss about future of river science. And as mentioned, I am currently faculty at IIT Gandhinagar. The next talk will be on the interlinking of rivers, the very well known top topic. It will be by Sri N.K. Bhandari. So Dr. Bhandari is a 1987 batch alumni of Department of Hydrology. He did M.Tech from there. And he was a former chairman of the Ganga Flood Control Commission and also chairman of the Dam Safety Review Panel of the Government of Gujarat. The fourth talk will be on the water quality. It will be by Sri J.C. Sethi, who will discuss about the wastewater and its treatment. He is a 1975 alumni. He did B.Tech from the Mechanical Engineering. He was a former project director and also the water management project, consulted to many agencies involved in the water treatment and agencies. So he will share his rich experience with us. The fifth talk will be on the glaciers as the source of water, on the glacial water availability aspect. It will be by Dr. Ram Rajak, Dr. Razak is an alumni of Civil Engineering Department, 1990 batch, ME student, and he's presently the head of Geoscience Division at Space Application Research, ISRO Ahmedabad. And the last talk will be on the snow cover and climate change. It will be more on the futuristic aspect and how our water availability will be a major challenge. It will be by Dr. Sushil Singh, who is a 1997 alumni of Earth Sciences Department, M.Tech graduation with Applied Geophysics degree. And he is presently scientist at ISRO Ahmedabad. So with this background and with this brief information, I once again welcome you all towards this exciting journey of this 3-week journey for this water management. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Dr. Vikrant Jain. In fact, we are happy that we have started this lecture series, and the degree of our happiness has no bound, because the lecture series is being inaugurated by none other than Professor Ajit Chaturvedi, the director of IIT Roorkee, in August presence of Professor Sudhir Jain, who is director of Gandhinagar IIT, IIT Gandhinagar. We are fortunate that these two great academic personalities are present with us today. We have got an opportunity to listen their views. So first of all, I request Professor Sudhir Jain to deliver his guest of honor address. Although you all know Dr. Sudhir Jain very well, I gently remind you, as Deepak Mathur has already told, that he is a Padma Shri awardee. Recently, he has also been awarded a distinguished alumni by IIT Roorkee. He has been supporting all our ITRA Ahmedabad activities wholeheartedly, and he has been guiding us since many years. He joined IIT Gandhinagar as its founder director in June 2009, and he is serving his third term as director of the institute. He is professor of civil engineering at IIT Gandhinagar. May I request Professor Sudhir Jain to kindly deliver his guest of honor address. Professor Sudhir Jain, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajak. Thank you, everybody, for providing this opportunity. Let me not take much time. Let me first express appreciation for Professor Ajit Chaturvedi to be able to spare the time. And I have known him for very, very long time at IIT Kanpur, ever since he joined there as a faculty member. And I must say that nobody was perhaps more happy than I was when I heard that he will be the director of Roorkee, because knowing him, how well he worked at IIT Kanpur in various academic and administrative roles, I knew that he will be not only the finest director that Roorkee has ever seen, but he will be the finest director in the entire IIT community, IIT system. And I have been proved right based on whatever I have watched Roorkee do over the tenure of Professor Chaturvedi in last several years. So very, very excited that Professor Chaturvedi was able to spare the time on a Saturday afternoon to be with us today. The experience of being in Ahmedabad for almost 12 years now and working with everybody in ITRA has been, again, a very, very humbling experience to see dedicated set of people sitting more than 1,000 kilometers away from Roorkee, but still, after decades, thinking of Roorkee, breathing of Roorkee, and always wanting Roorkee to do well. I have not seen a more passionate bunch of people about enthusiastic about their alma mater. I have dealt with a lot of alumni relations work at Kanpur, and I must say that what is happening in Ahmedabad is truly exceptional because of certain exceptional individuals. Many of them are here today with us, including Mr. A.C. Mathur and many others. And very rightly, the talk today is on water. And Roorkee, of course, the reason for creation of Roorkee was water, because the canal had to be dug and needed engineers to be trained. And that is how Roorkee came to being. And Roorkee has, of course, over the years made a great reputation on water-related matters. And therefore, it is no surprise that a lot of alumni of Roorkee also have made a mark in related areas of water. And in Dr. Ratan Jain, we have a very eminent, very senior expert, very eminent expert in water-related matters. And there are many more who will be speaking in due course in future lectures. So I must not take more time than this and say how grateful we are to Professor Chaturvedi for being here today and to everybody. And I looking forward to this series being a very, very successful series, setting a good example of how alumni chapters can go beyond only doing social activities. We do a lot of good social activities, but some years back we decided that we must do some non-social but technical type of activities, because after all, we are technocrats of some sort from Roorkee. And I'm very delighted that this series is taking off with leadership of many of you present today. Rajak is one, Vikrant is another, many, many others. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I wish this series all the success. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Professor Sudhir Jain, for your kind words. And you always keep us encouraging. Thank you so much. Now we move ahead further to hear an inaugural address by our chief guest, Professor Ajit Chaturvedi, who is director of IIT Roorkee. He is a person I don't have to introduce to many of you. He is a well-known national academician leading a premier institute of country, IIT Roorkee, to new heights. He is an electrical engineering product of IIT Kanpur. He has been to IIT Banaras. He has been to IIT Kanpur again before joining IIT Roorkee in 1999. There are a number of awards and many achievements in his name. He has immensely contributed in national telecom policy. Let us welcome Professor Chaturvedi to inaugurate this program and listen his views. Professor Ajit Chaturvedi, please, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Ram Rajak. At the outset, let me express my deep gratitude to the entire alumni fraternity at Ahmedabad, our IIT Roorkee alumni fraternity at Ahmedabad, for giving me this platform and opportunity to inaugurate this very unique and interesting lecture series. I think this is an idea that will sort of catch up with several other, alumni groups across the IIT system and not only IIT Roorkee, because this is something very, very unique, and it will bring alumni together because of the reasons that Professor Sudhir Jain was mentioning. I must thank Professor Sudhir Jain for really using very, very kind words for me. I don't know whether I deserve them, but it puts added pressure on me that I should live up to the expectations of my dear alumni. And of course, Professor Sudhir Jain is one of the very distinguished alumni that our institute has produced. I must also thank Shri A.C. Mathur. I think he is the moving spirit behind this Ahmedabad group. I always admire his passion and his interest in bringing the name of Roorkee forward, in bringing alumni of Roorkee together, and in trying to do things which will give an opportunity to all of us to talk about Roorkee, to spread the name of Roorkee, and to take Roorkee to greater heights. I think Mr. A.C. Mathur, your work is deeply applauded, and I hope that others will see you as an example, as a role model, and many more things will follow. Having said this, I would like to share a few things with all alumni who are listening to this lecture series, and I hope that whatever I'm going to share it will gladden your hearts. You'll be very happy to hear the things, because they resonate very well with the theme of this lecture series. About 4 years back, IIT Roorkee as an institute, we took a decision that in some senses, Roorkee is the water capital of the country. We use the word water capital. And the reasons all of you have already elaborated, of course, you missed a couple of departments. Maybe I'll add those two departments. I think Department of Earthquake Engineering and the Department of Architecture and Planning to the list that the departments that you've already taken names of, they provide a very unique combination under one roof by which we can do very, very important things and activities which have a critical and important role in the water resources sector. So the idea was that not only IIT Roorkee and these departments, but in our campus, as almost all of you know, we also have the National Institute of Hydrology. And just nearby, we also have the Irrigation Research Institute. So if we have so many water-related experts, so many institutes of national importance funded by central and state governments, it is very natural that we seize this opportunity and try to project this. And keeping that decision in mind, we try to do several things which are now taking more and more shape and flourishing as time passes. One of the activities that started after that was known as the Roorkee Water Conclave, RWC. So last year was the inaugural edition of Roorkee Water Conclave. And you'd be very happy to hear that just by the name of Roorkee, about 30 leading international experts came on their own. We just gave them this platform. We said that this is a Roorkee Water Conclave, and it was done in collaboration with NIH. NIH and IIT Roorkee joined hands to do the water conclave, and it proved to be an immense success with a lot of experts and a lot of very interesting lectures and theme workshops and a special session on Ganga. And even school children got excited. In fact, after the conclave, there was a 3-day exhibition only for school children. And there was an unending stream of school children coming and looking at that poster session on Ganga. And also there was a special session in the auditorium where all the students sat together. And I personally spent 2 hours there. It was a very exhilarating experience. And the second edition of RWC has already been announced. And I hope that our experts in water working in Ahmedabad or who are retired from the professional life, they will also get to see that proceedings of the RWC. Next year, it is in the month of March 2022, the second edition. Taking it forward, we also now have a coordination committee with NIH. And incidentally, that coordination committee is meeting just in the last week of this month again, after a gap of some time. And we have given several privileges to each other in terms of defining an MOU, getting a project off the ground, giving PhD opportunities, giving access to facilities to each other. So we have come quite sort of collaborative in nature with NIH. And the third initiative that I want to mention today is, and that happened last year, this was that all government sectors, academic institutes, whether funded by central government or state government, within a radius of about 100 to 150 kilometers around Roorkee. And you'll be surprised to know that that number is not less than 40, 45. The IIT Roorkee took the initiative to invite them to IIT Roorkee last year. And the theme was water, nothing else. The common word that brought all these institutes together was water. And all of you remember the Senate Hall? The Senate Hall was full of directors, full of scientists, professors, chief engineers, regulators. You think of Uttarakhand, Haryana, UP, Punjab, Himachal, Uttarakhand, all these states, they were there. And the idea was that many of the interesting things can be done only if we forge partnerships. We cannot do it alone. And this was what was resonating with everybody. After that, about 4 projects were crystallized. They are at different stages of conception and evaluation. And the next meeting of this group is again now happening next month. And this time, of course, it will be an online meeting. So again, we hope to see that the energy and the momentum built by the previous meeting would be carried forward. And gradually, it is gravitating in the direction that what is there de facto would become de jure. That means Roorkee is the water capital of the country. So that is the direction. And now, before I end, I have 2 more interesting things to talk about. Mathurji and Rajajji, please give me time, although you gave me 5 minutes. So give me 5 more minutes. So, and I'll conclude very soon. So what has happened is that in collaboration with the Central Water Commission and the Ministry of Jal Shakti, we have come up with two big initiatives. One is what is known as the International Center of Dams. This project is at a very, very advanced stage. We hope that it will become a reality in a few months' time. And the reason for that is that India has 5,334 large dams in operation and 411 large dams which are under construction. And the footprints of IIT Roorkee can be seen in almost all the major dam projects of the country and in many other dams throughout the world. Many of the existing dams are very old and need rehabilitation. The safety of these dams is of utmost importance. We are at the final stages towards the establishment of an international center for dams and develop it as one of the most advanced centers in the world. The center shall focus on the complete cycle of dam safety, starting from planning of a dam, design, construction, operation, maintenance, including policy and financing. The center will aim at promoting new technologies and improving institutional capacities for dam safety evaluation and implementation in India as well as in other countries. Subsequently, the center will also take up the task of the complete design of new dams in India as well as abroad. Coming to another initiative, IIT Roorkee has taken the lead to establish a new MTech program on dam safety and rehabilitation in collaboration with Central Water Commission, Ministry of Jal Shakti. It is likely to start in 6 months, that is from August 2021. It has to still go through some formal approvals, but we are hoping that those approvals will be in place and then we can start this MTech program on dam safety. Living in North India and at the same time, when we are at the place where, can you hear me? Is there some?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So living in North India and at close to the place where we, Ganga has originated, my talk will not be complete unless I talk about NMCG, National Mission on Clean Ganga. And I'm very happy to share with our alumni that just 2 days back, the Director General of NMCG was in the campus. He came from Delhi only for Roorkee. He spent a day with us and went back to Delhi. And he along with him, we inaugurated the Stable Isotope Lab. This Stable Isotope Lab is currently the best in the country. The second best facility is at another academic institute at Bangalore, IISc Bangalore. And it will allow us to do very interesting basic science and applied science problems in geology, in hydrology, in environment, in water pollution, in Ganga pollution, in all these areas. And with the discussion that have happened with the DGNMCG, I think we are not far away from establishing a center which will be funded by NMCG. Again, that as I said, that center will also be focused on water-related aspects. So this theme that you have chosen is very close to our heart. It resonates very well with us. I think the entire Ahmedabad alumni team needs a great round of applause for choosing a theme which resonates with us so well. Before I end, of course, I've taken a lot of time. I have just two appeals to make. One appeal is that every year we announce this nominations for inviting Distinguished Alumnus Awards. And lot of jewels of Roorkee are spread all over the globe who have not been nominated. So please help us in digging out those jewels, in nominating them, so that whatever recognition which is overdue to them, at least we can recognize our stalwarts, heroes, people who have done so well, our alumni who have done so well. So that is one appeal that I have to all my alumni. And the second appeal to Ahmedabad-based alumni is that if you are not getting the messages from the director and the dean, we sent every few months, we send some messages or some news about the institute. Please get your ID included in our database. I will request Shri A.C. Mathurji to take the lead in this regard. Anybody whose ID is not there, please let your ID to Shri Mathurji. And we will make sure that we include your ID in your database so that you get more connected. You are already emotionally connected with us, but get more connected with us because you will get regular news from the campus. And I'm sure that news will gladden your hearts and you will feel more proud of being alumni of IIT Roorkee. Thank you again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for inaugurating this lecture series and telling us about our alma mater, that is IIT Roorkee, and the kind of developments that they are happening there. So we are really very happy to listen it. And for your thank you so much for your kind words. Now this program is inaugurated by our chief guest. Friends, it is time to go for today's lecture. But before we listen today's lecture, I request Joint Secretary of ITRA Ahmedabad, Dr. Mukesh Ranjan, to introduce today's speaker, Dr. R.C. Jain. Dr. Ranjan is a scientific officer in IPR Gandhinagar. He completed his MSc in physics from IIT Roorkee in 2009. Dr. Mukesh Ranjan, please.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Rajak, for giving me this opportunity. We already know the importance of this very important water management lecture series. So I will not take much time. Today we have an eminent speaker who is giving the inaugural lecture, Dr. R.C. Jain. So he has a very big resume, but I will be only highlighting few of his achievements in this. So Dr. R.C. Jain did his master degree in applied geology with gold medal from University of Roorkee. And later he did his PhD in integrated water resources management from Rajasthan University. He started his career in a groundwater board in 1979 and superannuated as chairman of Central Groundwater Board and Central Groundwater Authority of India in the year 2014. He was national coordinator for implementing prestigious national program of aquifer mapping and did the mapping for the entire country. He has, other than this, he has published 50 international peer-reviewed publication on this various topics. Presently, he is working as an advisor groundwater for the Gujarat government and for Water Resources Development Corporation, Government of Gujarat. So with this brief introduction, I will require Dr. R.C. Jain, sir, to please give us your lecture series. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Vikrant Jain, may please display his presentation.
Okay, can you? Okay, so good evening, everyone. I am R.C. Jain here, and I am going to speak on the topic groundwater resources and sustainability. Next slide, please. So if you look at the water availability scenario in the country, the total precipitation received in the country is of the order of something like 3,900 million cubic meters. But evaporation losses account for nearly 45% of the total precipitation we receive. And as a result, the annual water availability has been assessed around 2,000 billion cubic meters in the country, out of which only 1,122 BCM is considered to be utilizable because of the constraints of topography, hydrology, and other factors. So the surface, out of this, the surface water component is 690 billion cubic meters. And already we are utilizing 450 BCM, for which we have created the storages. In the groundwater side, about 430 billion cubic meters is the annual replenishable recharge, which gets replenished every year. And we are already utilizing something like 250 billion cubic meters out of this. So what is happening is, over the time, due to the increased demand for water, there is a reduced availability, per capita water availability, as you can see here. The availability at the time of independence was of the order of something like 5,000 plus cubic meters per person, which has decreased to about 1,545 cubic meters per person in the year 2011, and further it is decreasing. So we are already below the water stress line, which has been defined by Fahrenheit as availability of 1,700 cubic meters per day per year, per person. Now, if you look at the scenario of the water demands, the water demands are ever increasing, as you can see from this picture, see from 2010 to 2025, and then to 2050. So already in the year 2050, we will be requiring something like 1180 BCM, which and that amount of water is really not available as per the current projections. So then, say the, let us go to the next slide. Next slide, please. Okay, so you see what has happened because of this is, you can see the situation, what is happening is that, you know, the manifestations of this are in the surface water component, there is drying up of lakes and ponds, reduction in the environmental flows, and there is contamination. In the groundwater sector, we see the desaturation of aquifers, and that is leading to drying up of the shallow wells, declining in groundwater levels, reduction in the well sustainability, and increasing energy costs and carbon footprints. Then also contamination is also an important factor, and which is geogenic, that is because of the natural regions, because of the geology of the rock formations in which water is contained, and also there are man-made regions. And the problems are more visible in the groundwater domain. Next one. Next slide, please. So, see, if you look at the groundwater part of it, on which I will be stressing more, groundwater now meets about 60% of the total irrigation needs of the country, 85% of the rural drinking water needs, 50% of the urban water needs. And in the last 40 years, groundwater has basically contributed more than 80% in increasing the net irrigated area. Groundwater contributes to about 10% of the GDP. And since 1975, Indian agriculture has emerged as the world's largest user of groundwater, bypassing the total groundwater withdrawal of China and USA taken together. So now the issue is, can we sustain this level of utilization? Then if you look at the, can you click on the right hand side? There is a graph here. Yes. So this graph shows that how the consumption of water is increasing over the years. Then you can see that in India from 1980 onwards, see the trajectory is so high. While the US and China, they continue to be around 100 BCM. We are already more than around 250 BCM. So this is the status of affairs. Next one. The Central Groundwater Board, in collaboration with the state governments, carried out the Dynamic Groundwater Resources Assessment, that is the resources which gets replenished every year because of rainfall, canal applied irrigation return, and water conservation structures. So this is estimated to be about 430 million cubic kilometers, of which because of the environmental flow and other requirements, this extractable groundwater is of the order of 390 million cubic meters. And annual drought, as I said, is already 249 million cubic meters. The stage of groundwater development over the country as a whole is 63.3%. But this is not uniform across the country. What we see here is the assessment units in which the groundwater assessment is carried out. The country is divided into 6,881 assessment units. They are basically the administrative units. And we have over-exploited and critical blocks constituting about 1,500 blocks in the country, which makes something like 22%. Now, these blocks are basically located in the northwestern part, that is Punjab, Haryana, then Rajasthan, parts of Gujarat, and parts of also Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. So this is a situation which calls for certain immediate measures to be taken. Next one. Next slide, please. Now, you see, this is what is already happening, and then the situation gets further exasperated because of the climate change. Because as per the fifth assessment report of the integrated intergovernment panel, of the intergovernment panel on climate change, the key findings are that projected change in the frequency of extreme rainfall for future decades, that is relative to 1861-1870 baseline, is going to increase. So if extreme rainfall events are there, you see, we have got more of floods and less of recharge, and this will ultimately affect the actual availability of water in the country. Then there is a rise in the temperature also. Can you go to the next slide, please? So what is ultimately going to happen is basically there is an increase in the frequency of extreme precipitation, which would mean that much of the monsoon rain would be lost as direct runoff, resulting into reduced groundwater recharge. And at the same time, this would also require more groundwater withdrawal to meet our requirements. Further, this will further exacerbate the present situation of imbalanced groundwater development, with more than 22% of the assessment units being classified as over-exploited or critical. Hence, groundwater sustainability is a major challenge under the climate change scenario also. Next one. Now, as I have said, see, this is just a summary of basically what is happening because of this increased groundwater drawdown. The causes are the depletion, reduction in recharge, erratic rainfall and urbanization, then extraction in excess of the replenishment, that is inefficient water use, improper cropping patterns, power, subsidy and free power, and lack of awareness. Then contamination is also, causing further problems. Natural contamination is basically the geological rock formations, which contribute fluoride, arsenic, some places iron and like that. And then there are man-made issues like agriculture contributing to nitrate pollution, then industries, causing discharge of the untreated, partially treated effluents and are ultimately leading to contamination of groundwater, then urban sewerage, which is mostly untreated in major part of the country, and then sedentary intrusion also. So these are the major causes, which need to be taken care of if you want to have a sustainability of the groundwater resource in the country. Next one. Now, how did we get here? Basically, we have ignored the science of hydrogeology, and we have also ignored the common pool resource nature of groundwater. The thinking was that wherever you own a piece of land, you construct a tube well and you can do pumping to any amount of water. So everybody thinks that the water contained below his piece of land belongs to him, but it is not like that. So this is the common pool resource nature of water which we have to consider. Then we have also ignored sustainable demand management. We have been doing, a colossal waste of, water through our conventional techniques of irrigation or flooding. And then a lot of water gets basically lost as evaporation, and it is not basically utilized by the crops. Then we have ignored reuse and recycling of the water. There is a great possibility, there is a great potential to reuse and recycle the water which we are using for various purposes. Then the other most important aspect is we have placed surface water and groundwater in separate silos. So far, the thinking has been surface water is something which is visible and it's a manifestation of what you can really observe and measure. Groundwater, it is always thought of that, it is a, very small component and it is not visible and there are so many complexities. As a result, this total resource of water has not been considered as a single resource. And this has resulted into basically over-exploitation of groundwater resources. Then this has been further, exacerbated by a perverse structure of pricing of water and power, which is, the most minimal pricing is there for surface water. For groundwater, basically, there is no pricing. And then, even power is free in many of the states. And the other aspect is, the legal aspect, that is, we still follow the British common law, which was enacted a century back in the year 1882, in the 19th century. Next one. Next slide, please. So, what is the implications of this law? This is very important because this was the law which is being followed so far. It provides for unlimited access of land, water below the land of the landowner. It ignores the fact that the land ownership boundaries are not coterminous with the aquifer boundaries, because we need to consider the aquifer as a reservoir of groundwater and not the boundaries on the surface. It also ignores the fact that aquifer water is necessarily a common pool resource. Aquifer is accessed by many people and it is not a resource confined to your own piece of land. And then ultimate unlimited extraction of groundwater levels, it leads to fall in the groundwater tables, water quality adversely deteriorates and ultimately impacting all the stakeholders. And then there are serious growing conflicts over groundwater use. Next one. So now, what to do? How we are going to, sustain our resources? So what has happened is, these are the solutions, possible solutions for water security and water resilience. what has happened is, over the years of late, the dialogue and modern environment has significantly shifted towards ways in which the environment can not only be conserved and managed, but it should be able to meet the needs also sustainably, with a focus on working with nature to co-produce benefits for both people and nature. Now, nature-based solutions for water have contributed importantly to this dialogue. And if you look at it, there are two options. Number one is the option of building more surface water reservoirs. But this is now very limited because of the decreased runoff, the reservoir siltation, and the environmental conditions, and the fact that most of the cost-effective and viable sites have already been used up. In addition, increasing water temperatures lead to increased losses through water evaporation also. So the other option is, next one. So as a part of this shift, groundwater and the subsurface environments that contain the water, that is aquifers, are increasingly seen as strategic and integral resources for enhancing the water supplies and other natural ecosystem services that supports the human development resilience. Hence, it is increasingly important to enhance, manage, and sustain services derived from the nature-based solutions of the infrastructure of aquifers through managed aquifer recharge by managing and optimizing the underground water storages to increase the resilience in dry periods or seasons of uncertain and variable climate. Next one. Now, the nature-based, in the light of technological advances and increasing knowledge and experiences in India related to groundwater and sustainable environmental processes, a broad portfolio of approaches indicated below that permit better management of these natural resources and services in India have been examined in this paper. I have examined those aspects in terms of their technical feasibility, social relevance of implementation. The important issues which were examined are enhancing recharge of aquifers, mandating water harvesting and artificial recharge in urban areas, groundwater governance, incentivizing to promote recharging of groundwater, intelligent power rationing for irrigation, optimizing water use efficiency, and community use management. Next one. So, enhancing recharge of aquifers. Rainwater harvesting for enhanced aquifer recharge, storage and recovery needs to be adopted as the most viable alternative, as managed aquifer storages played a key role in helping communities to adjust to climate change variability and uncertainty, and also by enabling the irrigators and other users to continue having access to water even during droughts. And also, this works in contrast to the centralized surface storages, because rainwater harvesting and artificial recharge of groundwater are decentralized, allowing diversification of water source types to augment for recharge. And the sources could be rainfall, it could be non-committed runoff, it could be urban storm water, and even treated wastewater. They can be utilized to recharge locally, and then the distributive nature of groundwater is there, you can extract it anywhere. Next one. So ultimately, it is the managed aquifer recharge which is most important for us in India. Managed aquifer recharge is a part of the palette of solutions basically to water shortages, water security, water quality decline, water tables, and endangered groundwater dependent systems. The immediate priority for implementing the rainwater harvesting artificial recharge to manage aquifer recharge is the following area. As I said in my previous slide, the groundwater stressed area, which are about 1500, which are over exploited and critical, where already our drawal is more than 90 to 100% of the recharge, and there is a severe decline in groundwater table. Then there are coastal areas which are affected by seawater ingress, and also by the haphazard development of groundwater through unscientific means, leading to salinity ingress. And then there are issues like areas infested with pollution due to various regions, geogenic and anthropogenic pollution also. Next one. So the Central Groundwater Board in the Government of India has taken a task upon themselves and prepared a master plan for artificial recharge of groundwater, which has been recently released. It is available in public domain. So against the total area of the country of 32.87 lakh square kilometers, about 11 lakh square kilometers of the area has been identified to be suitable for artificial recharge, wherein it is estimated that about 537 BCM of subsurface space is available for storage of water. This includes also the hilly terrain of Himalaya, where structures are basically proposed to increase freshwater recharge and improve sustainability of streams. And the quantity of water which is required to saturate the aquifer up to 3 to 5 meters below ground level is about 716 million cubic meters. That is the quantity of water we need. But due to non-uniform distribution of rainfall, only the surplus water which is available has only been considered. And for the entire country as a whole, some 185 BCM of surplus water which goes unutilized is available. Based on the surplus water, it is estimated that the total cost of implementation of the master plan would be of the order of 1,33,000 crores. And that has a component of more than about 97,000 crores for rural areas and about 36,000 crores for the urban areas. Next one. Next one, please. Now, there are no special funds being provided by the Government of India, but there are, for implementing this kind of massive program, there are a number of schemes of the central and state government agencies which have got a component of water conservation, and they can be utilized to have the water conservation structures. They are just enumerated here, like MDNREGA, Integrated Watershed Development Program for Rainfed Areas, Bharat Nirman, Irrigated Agriculture Modernization through Restoration of Water Bodies, Drought Prone Area Program, NABARD Assisted Rainwater Harvesting Program for Rehabilitation of Tanks, identified by MLS, Command Area Development Program, Water Conservation in Reserve Forest Area, and Local Area Development Programs. These are some of the important programs through which the funding available can be utilized for water conservation. Next one. The other important aspect is contentive management. Contentive management of surface and groundwater will play a crucial role as a mitigatory measure, since climate change will lead to extreme situation of water level rise in some areas and water level decline in other areas. So in such event, we have to have contentive management of surface water and groundwater and rainwater, and this calls for evolving suitable plan for controlling the problem of rising groundwater levels by adopting technique of conjunctive use of surface and groundwater and proper drainage. This entails preparation of the sector-wise, block-wise plans for development of groundwater resource in conjunction with surface water based on the mathematical modeling results, especially in the command areas of large dams where we have the problem of water logging. Then to sustain the present irrigation pattern, its sustainability has to be tested to suggest improvement in future, what kind of future strategy should be there. And then to evaluate the cost and economic aspect of groundwater development with respect to the cost-benefit ratio, internal rate of return and payback periods, etc. So these will be the important factors which should be studied while implementing conjunctive use. Next one. Now, the other important aspect is intelligent management of irrigation and energy nexus. Because managing the energy irrigation nexus with sensitivity and intelligence is the principal tool for groundwater demand management. Tariff reform has proved to be a political challenge in many of the states, but other hybrid solutions need to be invented. Like Gujarat has experience of implementing the Jyoti Gram scheme, in which they have separated the agriculture and rest of the utility power lines, and dedicated power is made available to the agriculture feeder line for 8 hours in every village. So this kind of rationing, this is called intelligent power rationing, that has helped to restrict the actual pumping of water. Then some other states in the country too are moving in this direction of management by rationing of power, like Punjab. They have effectively used power rationing in summer to encourage the farmers to delay rice plantation by a month and thus significantly reduce the groundwater depletion. Andhra Pradesh gives farmers free power, but has now imposed a 7-hour ration. So these are some of the, you know, approaches in energy power nexus. How to, you know, energy water nexus, how to, you know, have a control. Next. Next slide, please. Okay. Then, as all of us know, that agriculture is the largest consumer of water, and it consumes nearly 80% of the total water utilized in our country for irrigation purpose. So substantial quantity of this water can be used, can be saved by introduction of the micro drip and sprinkler techniques. And we can save like 20% of the groundwater which is applied in the irrigated area. And if this is, you know, made operational, it is estimated that something like 15 billion cubic meters of water can be saved. That's a big quantity. Then viable solutions for balancing the agroeconomics with environmental equilibrium, including the following, needs to be adopted, like, you know, less water intensive crops having market, higher market value, especially in the areas which are not so abundant in water, like Haryana has introduced this model. They have introduced higher MSP for millet than rice in Haryana pilot, and it is reported that it is successful. Similarly, the scientific on-farm management practices, like precision irrigation, soil moisture crops in the Punjab pilot. Because people think that give more water and you will have more of, you know, production, but it is not actually required so much of water. So they have done a pilot with the help of the soil moisture probes, which they procured from Germany. And then it has been found that when the soil moisture availability is taken, is reaching the melting point, then only irrigation need to be given. So number of irrigations have been reduced. And as a result, groundwater pumping has been reduced. Similarly, in Andhra Pradesh, they have followed the rotational operation of tube wells to minimize the interference of the wells and also the depletion of water level. These are some of the approaches which can be followed. Change in cropping pattern may not necessarily lead to, you know, more of saving sometimes, because the people will have a tendency to have more irrigated area, you know, taken into consideration for applying the same quantity of water saved because of micro irrigation, but then ultimately the productivity increases. This has been the experience in Punjab and Haryana. Next one. Next one, please. Then the other option is potential use for inferior quality waters, which we just don't use actually. Recycling of wastewater from urban centers. Presently, 140 BCM per year is generated from our urban centers, but only less than 3% of this water is currently treated. After proper treatment, depending on the purpose of its use, this can be put to industrial, agricultural, and domestic uses to replace the fresh groundwater resources in the face of emerging scarcity. Similarly, in the urban settlements, we can have a system of dual water supply. Fresh water can be supplied only to meet the requirement of drinking water supply, and brackish or inferior quality groundwater can be provided for all domestic uses, like, you know, flushing and toilets and car mopping and things like that. Then there is a lot of potential for use of brackish and saline groundwater also, because yields of many crops and vegetables like barley, date, and pomegranate, when they are irrigated with the saline or brackish water, are not significantly affected. So we already have the research findings from the Karnal Institute of CSIR. This needs to be taken to the you know, ground level, and people need to be educated and made aware about it. It is estimated that the resources of this saline water in these states, Haryana, Punjab, Delhi, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Uttar Pradesh, Karnataka, and Tamil Nadu, are of the order of something like 1100 billion cubic meters. And this is a very big resource which can be put to use. The use of this resource will help save fresh or good quality water for use by other sensitive crops and also for other users. Next one. Then there is also a possibility of, you know, incentivization for optimizing the groundwater use. Like, we can offer suitable incentives for community water, community management of the new wells, lining of open channels or underground underground, or we can have lay the underground pipelines. This will lead to saving of about 10 to 15% of the water applied. Then installation of the capacitors and frictionless food valves can save something like 9 to 15% in power consumption. Then adoption of micro irrigation, as I said already, that can be also, you know, encouraged. Next one. So the government of India has now taken up a sort of pilot projects in several states, which is called Atal Bhujal Yojana, at a cost of something like 6,000 crores for the period 2021-25, which aims at sustainable management of groundwater through community participation in about 193 blocks, which are basically covering the overexploited and critical areas in 78 districts in Haryana, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, and Karnataka. And the interventions are both supply side as well as demand side interventions. The supply side interventions are to be implemented through augmenting the groundwater resources or arresting its decline. And the demand side interventions through introduction of water conservation technologies, practices like drip, sprinkler, pressurized pipes, crop diversification, etc., to reduce water consumption. And this will be actively supported by capacity building and institutional strengthening initiatives. Next one. Just excuse me, I'll take some water. If you look at the governance aspects, status of water, groundwater governance, basically Article 246 of the Indian Constitution places water resources in the legislative jurisdiction of the states. So water supply, irrigation, canal, drainage, embankments, water storage and water and power, and water power, they are under the purview of the states. Then the second aspect is there is no provision in Article 256 of the Constitution to grant power to state to legislate on environmental matters, because entire this over exploitation of the resource, then the contamination, etc., they are causing environmental degradation. These powers of environmental law is reserved only for the central government by a reserve clause of Article 248. So taking the benefit of this clause, the government of India created the Central Groundwater Authority, and they have also asked all the states to have their own authorities through the state legislation as per the distribution of power. Because as I said that, the most problematic law which is being, used for creation of, an extraordinary number of groundwater structures is that, groundwater is considered as an easement under this act, and landowners have unrestricted right. But recently, you see, there are more judgments of the Supreme Court, and the present position is changing. Next one. Now, there are many questions raised that can the groundwater legislation, which will be enacted by the states, can it override the Indian Easement Act 1882 given in the Constitution? So the Indian Easement Act, if you read it very carefully, it does not give owners of the land ownership of the groundwater, but it only proscribes behavior of people other than the owner to prevent access to the water under their sources. So what has happened is after 135 years since the enactment was made, there have been many advances in the science of hydrology, hydrogeology, and it is now well established that groundwater is not a steady resource imprisoned beneath the surface of the land, but it's a common pool resource. And if a common pool resource is there, it has to be governed through the principles of public doctrine. And this is what the Supreme Court has pronounced. Next one. Then there is another important part in the Constitution which says that all laws in force in the territory of India immediately before the commencement of this Constitution, so far as they are inconsistent with the provisions of this part, shall to the extent of such inconsistency be void. And this clause is basically there's a right to fundamental right to life, and fundamental right to life also gives a fundamental right to water. And as such, this act is inconsistent, and as such, this doesn't carry any force. But there is a lot of political will required at the state level to basically enact an act like this. Next one. So the government of India has been asking the states to enact their bills. Some about 17 states and union territories have already enacted their groundwater bills. But there were so many deficiencies in that. So the existing laws, which had focused in respect of the 17 states and union territories on regulating the use of the groundwater resources, encompasses a number of key changes to the existing approaches in the present bill. They have, Government of India has drafted a model bill in 2016 and it has been circulated to states for adoption. So this has strong emphasis on protection and conservation is one of the important changes which have been made in the change of in the climate change context. The objectives of the present bill are promotion of sustainable use without compromising the needs for future generations, adoption of integrated approach towards groundwater and surface water to ensure consumptive use, protection of ecosystems and their biological diversity, reduction and prevention of groundwater pollution and degradation, provides for preparation and implementation of binding aquifer and protection plans. So these aquifer-based protection plans, they will be called as groundwater security plans, and all the developments will have to be ultimately regulated through the groundwater security plans, which are made with the participation of the stakeholders, basically the people of the ground, people represented in the Gram Sabha. Then the bill also envisages creation of the groundwater protection zones for need-based regulation and protection of groundwater, where specific protection measures need to be taken. And it explicitly makes a link between groundwater law and environmental principles, such as intergenerational equity and precautionary principle. Next one. So the policy framework for groundwater sustainability. At present, the law and policy framework is deficient when it comes to addressing the broader connections between groundwater and climate change. First, despite clear recognition of fundamental rights to environment, water and sanitation, neither water legislation nor environmental legislation have clearly integrated a human right dimension, which has the potential to encourage the linking of climate change and groundwater in domestic regulation. Secondly, there is a tendency to view climate change as an issue to be addressed at the macro level, thus reinforcing the focus on centralization in water law rather than promoting the constitutional mandate of decentralization, which is particularly relevant in the context of groundwater regulation at local level. Further, there are also implementation challenges that must be overcome. These include inadequate governance, inappropriate policies that provide no clear priorities or directions to government agencies or their responsibilities, and very limited financial and human resources to manage groundwater resources and water supply systems. Then to view groundwater through the lens of climate change in a country like India provides a window of opportunity to conceive groundwater regulation to comprehensively integrate protection and conservation at the aquifer level, and effectively link surface water and groundwater, and recognize that climate change, like water, needs to be regulated on the basis of principles of subsidiarity and decentralization. Certainly, this is a difficult task, but it is not impossible, and it would be well worth the effort. The next one. Next slide, please. So ultimately, I have come to the final slide, the way forward. Now, in view of all the scenario and the situations, what could be done? So number one is, and which is most important, is that manage aquifer recharge, intelligent management of energy irrigation access, and participatory groundwater management offers a major opportunity for water secure and resilient India. MAR, that is manage aquifer recharge, is the most economic, most benign, most resilient, and most socially acceptable solution, but has not been given due importance in the past because of the lack of awareness of adequate knowledge of aquifers, immature perception of risk, and inadequate policies for integrated water management, including linking MAR with demand management. There is a great hope, and already very good results are available from the three-dimensional aquifer mapping and management program being carried out by the Central Groundwater Board, which is expected to cover the entire country by 2023. This program is expected to fill the knowledge gap and provide a boost to sustainable water management in the country through three-dimensional mapping of the aquifers, their resources, their quality, and vulnerability of use. Then we should also mandate through a progressively increased use of recycled and treated wastewater, this has huge potential, as I said, for substitution of fresh groundwater used in industrial, domestic, and agricultural sectors. In the domestic and industrial sector, it is for non-potable users. Then encouraging use of beneficial saline water for selected agricultural crops in western and northwestern India, where huge unutilized potential exists. Now, agriculture accounts for nearly 90% of the total groundwater draft. Hence, aggressive promotion and incentivization of agriculture and drip irrigation on a massive scale in the over-exploited and critical areas is very important as a demand-side management strategy to reduce the groundwater draft. Now, in the country, conjunctive management of rain, surface water, and groundwater also offers a hitherto exploited opportunities for supply-side management, and ultimately enabling legislation for suitable groundwater management and the instruments for groundwater governance needs to be established in the states for enforcement of the governance. I think next one, I think this is the last slide. Yes, thank you. Thank you, sir, I have finished.
Rajak sir, just for your information, Dr. B.R. Gurjar, who is the Dean of Alumni Affairs at IIT Roorkee, has also joined.
Yes, sir. Let us welcome Dr. B.R. Gurjar. And sir, you are most welcome to this water management lecture series. Just now we have heard first lecture of this series by Dr. R.C. Jain. So I will start with that. Thank you so much, Dr. R.C. Jain. And now I can see there are some questions.
Okay. I'll be happy to answer those questions.
Yeah, Dr. R.C. Jain, you have delivered such a nice lecture. It was very interesting. It has covered all aspects of groundwater resources and its sustainability. You have explained all elements in a very simple language. You have talked about the current scenario, about the future of groundwater status, reasons of over-exploitation of groundwater, and the measures that we need to take if we want that groundwater extraction remains sustainable. In a way, it was a comprehensively complete lecture. Thank you so much, sir. Now, I request Dr. Vikrant Jain to take up these queries, which I can see there are some queries one by one, and I request Dr. R.C. Jain to please answer these queries. So, Dr. Vikrant Jain, please.
Many thanks, Dr. Rajak. So, now the floor is open for the questions. So, I request all the attendees, if they have any question, please write in the question or answer or in the chat box. And this floor is also open for question. So all the panelist members, I will request that they can unmute their microphone and they can directly ask the questions. So first I invite the panel members. And if there's no other questions, then I have one question.
There is one question by Mathur, sir.
I have one very general question because this subject is, I'm not an expert in that, just as a layman. The position of groundwater in this area of the country like Gujarat, how it is in comparison to other states?
The groundwater table is available at a great depth in Gujarat, especially in the North Gujarat area. You have got the water table ranging anywhere between 60 to 140 meters below ground level. This is something you don't get in any part of the country, excepting some parts in Punjab and also in some parts in Tamil Nadu. So we are having very deep water levels in North Gujarat area, which is also underlined by the major potential aquifers. There is a huge potential, but there is a huge decline as well.
Okay. And second thing is the present Government of India policies to conserve groundwater are okay, or they need more awareness among the common men of the country?
No, awareness is very, very important. As I said, that there are so many issues wherein awareness has to be created. You know, the first awareness is basically in terms of, you know, educating the people that the water below your land does not exclusively belong to you. It's a common pool resource. All the people who are tapping this aquifer, they need to utilize it in a coordinated and a participatory manner. And if the utilization exceeds the recharge, we have to take measures for artificial recharge as well, so that sustainability is maintained.
Dr. Jain, can you just share with the audience the aquifers, you know, like how they are charged by, you know, like this rain harvesting?
Well, I don't have a, you know, picture available right now, but, you know, rainwater, basically, you know, the purpose of rainwater harvesting is to accelerate the recharge rate to groundwater. You know, natural recharge takes place its own pace. But if you would like to increase the recharge to any of the aquifers, then you will have to construct some civil structures. Those civil structures could be in the form of injection wells, they could be in the form of recharge shafts, they could be in the form of spreading basins. So all these kinds of structures created on the surface, which accelerate the recharge, the rate of recharge to groundwater, will help in augmenting the resources at a rate higher than the normal natural recharge which takes place.
I was just reading somewhere, you know, like many of these, you know, like there is a thrust that whatever the new constructions are coming or the new buildings are coming, they have been, you know, like encouraged for making the rainwater harvesting wherever they are constructing the structures, at least the big societies. So the underground water charging can carry on. And basically, you know, like something perhaps, you know, like with respect to the rainwater harvesting for the societies or for the houses, how they can be built. It will be helpful for the, you know, like to many who are in the audience today.
Yes, actually, you know, there is a mandatory provision in the building bylaws that in all those areas where the plot area exceeds 200 square meters or the water table is below 20 meters below ground level, the builder has to necessarily construct an appropriate rainwater harvesting structure for recharge to the groundwater. That appropriate rainwater harvesting structure could be a recharge pit, could be a recharge well, could be a recharge shaft, depending on the hydrogeology of the area. But basically, if you are able to tap all the water which is available on your rooftops, which otherwise causes problems of flooding in the, you know, urban landscape, we will be able to utilize this water after treatment for direct recharge into the aquifer, which is identified from where major pumping is done. And there it is possible to significantly control the declining water levels, because you will be adding a large quantity of water, which is of a purest quality, directly to the aquifer. And this will help in sustenance of the you know, drinking water tubules of the societies as well. This has happened in Delhi. See, we had a campaign in Delhi, and when I used to be there in Delhi with the chief minister, see, we requested that you please provide incentivization to the people. So in Delhi now, an incentive is available to any residential society which undertakes rainwater harvesting and recharge to groundwater to the extent of rupees 1 lakh, that is the maximum ceiling. And the approximate expenditure basically on construction of a rain water recharge facility in Delhi is about rupees 2 lakhs. That's what I said, rupees 2 lakhs. So the society needs 50% as an incentive. 50% the people have to invest. So that kind of, you know, incentivization can also be encouraged in other areas, because we need to save the precious water which is going as a waste.
Yeah, any other questions? Other question from the panel members?
Yeah, Vikrant, I have just two queries.
I request you to open your video camera, and then it will be a good one-to-one discussion.
Okay.
Yeah, please go ahead with the question.
Sir, actually there are two queries. One is that initial slide you have shown one curve of India groundwater utilization will shoot up from 1980 many times, comparison to US and China type of countries, because of this agriculture revolution. So whether it is reflected also in the production in comparison to those countries, or only it shows the utilization of the groundwater in comparison to this US and China, whether it is reflected in production wise also at the same level or slightly higher. And the second query is, like you were telling, this aquifer use for a join of society of residential area. So these sort of aquifer maps are available for the implementation purpose or not?
Okay. Okay. So coming to your first question, that you want to know about the can you
first one is that shoot up from 1980 since 1980.
Okay, please. So we have been able to increase the production of food grains also, and now we have become an exporting country. You see, earlier we were a begging country. Say till 1970 we used to beg for our food supplies, but from 1970s onwards our production has also increased significantly. We have not been able to increase our production to the level of China or the USA, but definitely the production has increased, and the increase in production has been brought about by more irrigated area and coming into actual implementation, and more irrigated area required more of waters. And because groundwater is something which is ubiquitous, it is present everywhere below the ground. While you see, in case of command area, you are limited to the specific availability only in the command area. So there was a big boost to groundwater use for agricultural production when India transformed itself into a green country. Then the second part of it is you want to say about the utilize this society. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. That aquifer this boundary so that it can be restricted to particular zones. So that sort of maps are available for implementation purpose.
Yes, actually the Central Groundwater Board has carried out aquifer mapping in nearly 50% of the area of the country and about 60% of the area of Gujarat state, and the aquifer maps are available on the website in the public domain for utilization by everybody. So there the aquifers are demarcated, their water levels, water quality is given, and even the potential for production and recharge is also given on a thumb rule basis. You see, that will vary from area to area, but the CGWP has done a mapping on 1:50,000 scale. So 50,000 is something you can work on the ground also with those maps, and maybe some details can be acquired. So those maps are basically planned for utilization for implementation of the master plan on artificial recharge, which I discussed. That for implementation of the plan, the potential areas have been demarcated where there is a need for recharge and there is a suitable aquifer which exists to accept the recharge, both the things. And the third part is the source actually. So source water is many places deficient. Like you need more water in North Gujarat for recharge, but you don't have so much. In South Gujarat, you have got so much of water, but there is no issue of groundwater depletion. So like these, countrywide, the conditions vary. But these aquifer maps, they will provide a technological support and relevance to the demand and supply side management programs.
I would like to share here one thing with Sushil.
Yes, sir.
Terminal 3, T3, Delhi International Airport, when I was working as a project director for the water management system for Terminal 3, the complete airport has been designed with the water harvesting. That is, the water runoff which is coming alongside the runway actually has been designed with the water harvesting to boost the water, whatever is required, because that was one of the requirements. As we were using the raw water, so conversely, we had to do the water harvesting of the aquifers along that airport area. This is something which helps in bringing up the aquifer charge and water level above the ground.
Yes, sir. Actually, at the same time, I will also share one thing. Like our office and our society where we work and we are living, so already for the last many years, this recharge well sort of things are already working here. So whatever the rain water is coming, it slowly goes and drained into the groundwater at our office and our residential area.
Okay. Good, very good. That's a very good.
I think, sir, now this is mandatory for all the societies.
This is mandatory. This is mandatory. Yes, this is mandatory. Right.
Thank you very much, sir.
So, if there is no further question, let me thank Dr. R.C. Jain, Dr. Vikrant Jain, Mathur Saab, then Dr. Sushil, then CDG, everyone, to contribute in this question answer session. And now let me inform you all that Dean of Resources and Alumni Affairs of IIT Roorkee, Dr. B.R. Gurjar, has just now joined us. And he is an environment engineering professor in civil engineering department of IIT Roorkee. He has been instrumental and mobilizing IIT Roorkee alumni activities, and he takes keen interest in promoting alumni activities. So on this occasion, may I request Dr. Gurjar to say a few words about alumni activities. Dr. Gurjar, please.
Thank you, Dr. Rajak. Sorry, I joined this program late. I had a class, and it was very interesting to listen to Dr. Jain on aquifers. And this was kind of, issues we were discussing with the students of first year, because we have one introduction of civil engineering course in which environmental engineering is also a component. And there, all these water treatment, wastewater treatment, availability of water resources, all these things are also discussed. So first of all, I would like to thank you, alumni of Ahmedabad, city as well as, nearby areas who have joined hands to organize this lecture series. These kind of activities are very important, not only to connect with the institute, but also to give to the society. So the awareness as well as technological and technical aspects will be discussed in these lecture series. That would be very beneficial to all the people, including technocrats, designers, engineers, and who are, having keen interest in water resources. So these kind of activities are expected, and as DORA or Dean of Resources and Alumni Affairs, I always look forward to interact with our alumni, whether they are in India or abroad, and individually as well as in terms of groups. So we have several avenues. In fact, for example, you are imparting knowledge through these lectures. When situation is better, you can come over to the institute also. You can interact with our students. If you have time, you can visit for 2-3 days or for a week if you have interest in academic activities or research activities. So there are several avenues. I can give you the link. Through those avenues, you can associate with the institute and contribute in various ways. So that is all I would like to say, that please be in touch with your alma mater, and your alma mater is always look forward to interact with you. It's like, mother-child relationship, which goes forever. It is never, it never ceases to exist. So thank you for this opportunity, and I thank again and praise this effort or these initiatives which you have taken. I hope this will multiply from groups of alumni in different locations of the world. Thanks again.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Gurjar. Thank you so much. Although it is the culture of our ITRA Ahmedabad to felicitate our guests and our speakers, but due to COVID-19, we are not able to do these physical activities. We express our heartiest gratitude to our chief guest, Professor Ajit Chaturvedi, our guest of honor, Professor Sudhir Jain, and our speakers and our senior alumni. And now I request Dr. Vikrant Jain, he may please display the felicitation slide to appreciate the speaker, Dr. R.C. Jain.
Yes, there. So we had many thanks for the excellent talk by Professor Jain.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Now, before I request our host to take screenshots of all the panelists, I request Secretary ITRA Ahmedabad, Sri Himanshu Thosiyar, to propose formal vote of thanks. Sri Himanshu Thosiyar is a senior geophysicist at Ceylon Exploration Tech Limited. He completed his M.Tech from IIT Roorkee in 2002. He will also provide information about tomorrow's lecture. Sri Himanshu, please.
Thank you, Rajak sir. Thanks very much. So, very good evening to all. I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this memorable occasion. Let me start by giving glory to the Almighty God for making today's occasion a resounding success. First and foremost, I am very thankful to our chief guest, Professor Ajit Chaturvedi, that is director of IIT Roorkee, to grace the event and spending his valuable time in spite of busy schedule. I am really thankful to our guest of honor, Professor Sudhir Jain, director, IIT Gandhinagar, for providing his valuable guidance and extending support to all requirements in organizing this event. I am also thankful to Professor B.R. Gujjar, Dean IIT Roorkee, for providing his valuable time for this event. I would like to express my gratitude to Mr. A.C. Mathur, President of IIT Roorkee Alumni Association Ahmedabad, for his minute-to-minute guidance and support, for providing encouragement at every point of time in organizing this great event. I am also thanks to our speaker, Mr. R.C. Jain, for delivering such a nice and thoughtful lecture, which will be beneficial for students, institutions, and ordinary people. I thank our Vice President, Mr. Deepak Mathur, and Mr. Harjinder Singh for their support, vision, and commitment. And I also express my heartfelt thanks to Mr. Vikram Jain for his valuable contribution. I am also thankful to all senior members of ITRA for monitoring progress and suggestions in crucial time to tackle association issues. I am also thankful to UOR 77 Foundations, PAN IIT Gujarat, IIT Roorkee, IIT Gandhinagar, and Indian Space Industries Exhibitors Ahmedabad for supporting these lecture series. And you know, lot of works is involved to organize such events. I wish to express my sincere thanks to Mr. Manish Seth, Mr. D. Razak, Mr. Sushil Kumar, and Mr. Mukesh Ranjan to help us out and make it a grand event. And audience is backbone of such event. I am also thankful to all members who are here to be a part of this important event. And it may not be possible to thank all who have been involved during different part of preparations. So at the end, I would like to thank all of them for their support and help to make this event successful. Thank you all once again. And in the continuation of this webinar series, the next lecture, which is Future of Rivers in India, will be delivered by Dr. Vikrant Jain on 17th January, that is tomorrow at 5 p.m. And the link will be remain same. I request all the members, please join this webinar. Thanks again.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Himanshu. Now I request all the panelists, although they have already switched on their video, they may come please closer to their cameras. And I request Dr. Vikrant Jain to take snapshots.
So, yes, it is.
Done?
Done.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone, for joining this webinar. Let us again meet tomorrow at 5 p.m. Till then, take care and bye-bye. See you tomorrow.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Bye. Many thanks to all.
Thank you very much, Chaturvedi Sahab and Dr. Gujjar, for sparing your time attending this program.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Professor. Your old memory is coming true.
Thank you.
Thanks once again, sir.
Okay.
Okay, sir.